The drive from Portsmouth, Virginia to Branson, Missouri is approximately 1,150 miles, but it's almost all interstate driving. 25 other individuals and myself ended up at the Radisson Branson for a Rhodes Scholar program on Branson Showbiz. Over the next 4 days, we would experience behind-the-scenes activities, lectures by performers, and gain an overall appreciation for the difficulty in producing professional presentations for the general public. I hope you enjoy this video.
So glad you're here. Love Rhodes Scholar Tours. And I hope this one is as good as the ones you've been to, or better. And it's just a lot of fun. I want you to eat your dinner, and when dinner is over, I'm going to go through our itinerary, and so you'll know exactly what we're doing. And like I say, you don't have to remember anything, because I'm going to be with you all the time. I'll try to remember. My kids go, oh, Mom, you're really getting forgetful. It's the age thing, I think. But anyway, we'll go over that, and I'll tell you a little bit about me, and then I'd like to hear about you all and how many Rhodes Scholar Tours you've been on. I've had some that's been on like 170. Amazing.
Oh, wow.
But anyway, we'll go ahead and get our dinner eaten, and then we'll get down to business.
Okay.
Thank you. For a living, I'm retired now. I worked on the piers in Bayonne, New Jersey, on the docks. And I just brought in fueled ships and barges. Fossil fuel, did that for about 30 years. And then retired, and now I'm just roaming around anywhere I can be found. Wherever the wind blows, that's where Willie is.
It's all really right. Neat. I'm going to go ahead and start so we can get through this and get finished, but just go ahead and finish eating, and just enjoy your dinner. I'll tell you a little bit about me before I get into your itinerary. I have been a tour guide for probably 22 years, something like that. A long time. I always say I think I'm one of the oldest tour guides. I probably am one of the oldest. That's not the way I mean it. I mean it as I've been one the longest, probably. But anyway, I do enjoy it. I love it. I'm a retired school teacher, and I bet there are a lot of retired school teachers. It just seems like a lot of Rhodes Scholar people have been teachers. I'm a retired English teacher. I taught English in grades 7, 8, and 9. I did teach fourth grade once, and I loved it. I love all of them. But I come from a family. My husband was superintendent of schools. My daughter's a teacher, my son-in-law's a teacher, my husband's brother was a teacher, my mother was a teacher. She's in the 50s too, and they do some of the 70s and 80s music. But it's so fast-paced. Oh my gosh, you just wonder how they have the energy to do it. Oh, it's just unbelievable. And it's just so fun show. And they have a little skit in there about high school having a dance, and it's just so typical. I mean, it's just like when we were all in high school, going to that school dance, and I mean, it's just really fun. So you'll love it. And then we have a free hour and a half before dinner. We'll try to get, I try to get you back here to the hotel every time I can. Sometimes we'll have only 20 minutes, but I like to get you back to the hotel at least once during the day. If we're out quite a bit on the coach. So we have a little free time, about a half an hour and a half before dinner, but I don't think we'll have that because they don't think about at the office is, you know, is how long it takes you to get out of the theater, get on the coach, and that kind of thing. So we'll depart from the show about 5:15, and then, or from here, from the hotel, 5:15, and get to dinner by 5:30. 5:30 to 7, then 7 o'clock, depart for the Americana Theater, and that's when we do Raiding the Country Vault. That's our country music, and that would be the end of that day. So, like I say, you don't have to worry about anything because I'm going to be on that coach with you, and I'll watch the times for you, so won't be a problem. Any questions? I want to introduce to you Lynn Berry from the Chamber. She is the answer girl. I am telling you, if you've got a question, you talk to her and she'll give you the answer. She is phenomenal. You will love to listen to her. It is all about Branson. So let's welcome Lynn Berry.
Thank you. I'm Lynn Berry. I'm the Director of Communications for the Branson Lakes Area Chamber of Commerce and Convention and Visitors Bureau. My business card is this one. And I'm a transplanted Texan. I'm married a hillbilly. You can always tell us Texans, you just can't tell us much. And I'm delighted that I moved here in 1977 and wouldn't trade it. Would not trade all these beautiful rolling hills and these deep blue lakes for anything. Darling, there's one up in Canada that is larger. It's where the Bible comes to life. And Samson is currently being performed there. Next year will be the return of Noah, which is the one that started 12 years ago when we opened Sight and Sound Theater. Noah is an incredible performance. The ark is on the stage. You are surrounded by live and animatronic animals on three sides. It's a great performance. It surely is. They'll never run out of things to stage at Sight and Sound Theater. They've got the whole Old Testament to come through. I can't wait for the story of Ruth. So we'll go. Branson Airport. We opened our new airport at the beginning of the economic downturn, the worst economic downturn in the United States history since the Depression. And that proved to be a daunting factor.
Okay. Did it already? My watch is 10:30, so it's time to go. Time to start. So I want to introduce to you Bill and Dee Dee Lennon of the Lennon. Dee Dee, of course, of the Lennon Sisters. We are just so fortunate that they come to talk to us, and it's just amazing. I love it. And you will really, really enjoy it. So let's welcome Dee Dee and Bill.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Now you can.
Okay.
Good morning,
hear us both, I think, right? Yeah. There we go. Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Bill Lennon, and this is my older sister, Dee Dee. Every year. We both get older every year. It's a good thing.
I said that.
It's been my pleasure for really almost 20 years now to be doing elder hostel programs like the one that we're doing here today.
We're road scholar now.
I used to do, pardon?
We're road scholar now.
I understand, but it's still an elder hostel type program.
I didn't know that.
There we go. So we're going to talk about the Lennon Sisters and their career, how they got started in show business. And my sisters, through the years, sang for, 7 or 8 presidents, depending on which sister I talked to. They remember it slightly differently. But we're going to go through all that, and I hope we have some fun today. And at the end, we should have time for some questions, if you have any questions about anything.
Yeah, he was 10.
Okay.
That's right. And he killed after him.
It's funny. I remember this day, too. I was pretty young. But we had, the Dodge had started giving us a car once a year, a station wagon, for all of us million kids, because they were the sponsors of the Welk Show. And we went to the hospital to pick up Joe and my mom. And one time, one reason I remember is because they brought my mom out in a wheelchair, which was really weird to see her and the baby. And then we all got in the car, and Dad said, "Oh, I got to stop by the mechanics. They got to do something under the car." So with my mom and the new baby and all of us in the car, we got on one of those lifts. And we went up in there, and they did a little something. And then that was my dad. I'm sure my mom was laughing and chagrined at the same time.
At the same time, yes. Always.
Because we know this is the time frame when those things happen. But we're going to have a little history on the fiddle or the violin. And I'd like to introduce to you Nathan Adgepa. Got it?
Adgepa.
And Dean Church. And they are phenomenal. And they're probably going to start off with something really, really big for you.
I'm going to play a little fiddle tune. This is one that goes a long ways back. It's a great tune. It's kind of a standard that you learn when you're growing up. It's called Old Joe Clark.
Yeah, sounds good.
B of A. Here we go, Old Joe Clark.
Another nice tune,
Ashken?
Yeah, yeah. You guys probably seen the PBS Civil War tribute thing that they used to do in the documentary. This pretty much came from that. There was a guy by the name of Jay Unger that actually wrote this song for that documentary. And this it has that haunting Civil War time feel to it. To me, this is one of the most amazing ballad style songs for violins that for fiddling that I've ever heard myself. So we hope you guys enjoy.
Sorry.
Stand by for technical difficulties.
There we go. Got a button too close to you.
So. kind of like a snake wood looking, the markings on it. But this was the style back then. In fact, before they even had impens on them, they were just, I mean, you had to tighten it up by pulling on it and clipping it to get the straightness of the bow and to get it to hold. Nowadays, they put this pin in, probably, I'm gonna say mid-1600s, they started doing that. They put this pin in to tighten, to loosen the hair. That's how you keep from warping a good wooden bow.
If you kept it like tight all the time and you went in and out, it actually could shrink the hair and then the bow just turns the other way, which you don't want that.
Right, yeah, when you look at it like this, it's swinging this way or swinging that way. So when you go to pull, you're not gonna get the resonance like you would when it's everything straight. It's a funny thing, it's hard to explain on that one. But anyway, do you have a bow going?
Have a show or something you go to tonight, just don't worry about it. When you have to leave, just go ahead and leave.
We'll talk about you when you're gone, though. You want that dessert? It looks like cheesecake, maybe, huh? You just head on over and get you some while I set up here. Welcome to the Ozarks. I am so glad you're here. And I'm curious, how many of you are from Missouri? Wow, all the rest of you are from out of state. Wow. Well, welcome then. You've come a ways. My name is Judy Bowen, and I live about 45 miles northeast of here, just east of Springfield, Missouri, where I grew up on a farm near the town of Rogersville and still live on that farm today. And I'll tell you a little about myself as we go along, but I'll tell you what you're going to be hearing right now. You're going to be hearing what you won't hear anywhere else in Branson. It's not glittery, it's not showy, it's not new. You're probably not going to want to dance to it. You might want to pull out a Kleenex because you may shed a tear. Because I am going to be singing the old Ozark ballads. Now what I've been singing up here are the folk songs, American folk songs. They were common in the Ozarks and elsewhere in the nation. But the flip side of the folk songs are the ballads, which haven't lasted in popularity. They were very, very popular and sung a lot when people were milking the cows, when people were snapping beans on the front porch, when people were hoeing the corn. In other words, when they were working with their hands, but not necessarily their minds. That's the time to tell stories. That's the time to share long songs that have vivid imageries, little movies in your head, perhaps. And they're long, not longer than 3 minutes long, which doesn't fit radio airplay anymore. So they've kind of gone by the wayside. But I'm going to be singing those long, sad, sometimes true ballads to you tonight, along with a few original songs and some farm songs, because I'm very much in the world of farming. But that cheesecake over there, and a whole bunch of you don't have it, so you get up for it. What is it, cake?
Cheese.
Whatever it is, true song. I'm going to start you out with a sad ballad here. It's about a young boy who came from Texas. Okay, you got your napkin. Good to go. You're listening, I can tell. You get extra points. He was about 13 years old when his mother died and his dad remarried, and the stepmom and he did not get along. And so he lit out on his own. And this is the true story of what happened to Little Joe the Wrangler. He was Little Joe the Wrangler. He'll wrangle nevermore. His days with the remuda, they are o'er. It was a year ago last April that he rode into our camp. Just a little Texas stray and all alone. His saddle was a Texas cap made 30 was loosely tied behind, and his canteen or the saddlehorn was hung. He said if we would give him work, he'd do the best he could, though he didn't know straight up about a cow. So the boss, he cut him out of the mountain, kindly put him on, 'cause he's sorta like this little kid somehow. He learned to wrangle horses and know them all by name, and to get them in by daybreak when he could, to follow the chuck wagon and to always hitch the team, and to help Carcinado Russell Wood. We had driven down to Pegasus, the weather being fine, and camped on the south side in the bend, when a norther started blowing and we called out all our hands, 'cause we needed every man to hold them in. At last we got them milling and kind of quieting down, and the extra guard back to the wagon went. But there was one missing and we knew it at a glance. 'Twas our little Texas stray, poor Wrangler Joe. Next morning, just at daybreak, we found where Rocket fell, in a washout 20 feet below. And beneath his horse mashed to a pulp, his spurs had rung the knell. 'Twas our little Texas stray, poor Wrangler Joe. 'Twas our little Texas stray, poor Wrangler Joe. Okay, let me tell you a story about this one. This dates back to 1601, again in Scotland. Listen, I know on the evening news, when we watch the news, it's full of bad stuff. Just bad story after bad story after bad story. And you think, what is happening to this world? It's going south in a handbasket real quick. But I got to tell you something. People have always been bad to each other. So if that's any, you know, comfort to you. The world hasn't changed all that much. Because this case, this song shows it, okay? Back in 1601, there was a man who had a lot of land. And he had two children and a wife. And I don't know what happened to the wife. She's inconsequential in the story. So maybe she died in childbirth. So anyway, she's not mentioned. But he had these two kids. And he was concerned about who would take care of these two kids, a boy and a girl, when he was gone. So he chose his brother. And he said, brother, now listen, he said, if anything happens to me, I want you to take custody of the kids, and they inherit everything that I have. And I guess if anything happens to them, then you would get it, but that it won't come to that. Well, lo and behold, the fellow died. Brother got custody of the kids. Kids got custody of everything else. They were just little. Brother thought, I want this land, I want this money, I gotta get rid of these kids. So he hired a couple of ruffians to take the kids out in the woods. He said, kill them. Just whatever, you don't even have to tell me, and I'll pay you off. So these two kidnappers took the kids out in the woods. This is a true story, unfortunately. And something happened. I guess one of the kidnappers started to have doubts, and so they got into a tussle, and he killed the other kidnapper. And then he just left the kids. He abandoned them in the middle of the woods and disappeared. Well, the children died of starvation and the cold. Wait a minute. It gets happy because the kidnapper was found out, the uncle was found out, and they were both hanged. And that is a happy ending in a folk song. Justice. Person to person, it never stays the same. Even today, when I sing it, a different folk singer will sing it differently. But here in the Ozarks, all those years later, it was chipped down, and the only part of that story that remained is the burial of the two kids in the woods by the birds of the forest. And this song is as popular as Red Wing among the old-timers who sang these songs. So this was an important one here in the Ozarks. And this is all that's left of that story. My dear, don't you know, a long time ago, two poor little babes whose names I don't know. They were stolen away on a fair summer's day. They were left in the woods, I've heard people say. That when it was night, so sad was their plight. The sun had gone down, the moon gave no light. They sobbed and they sighed and they bitterly cried. The poor little things just lay down and died. And when they were dead, little robin so red brought strawberry leaves and over them spread all the day long. They sang them this song, poor babes in the woods, poor babes in the woods. Oh, don't you remember those babes in the woods?
I know you've got things to do, but I'll do just a few more here and thank you, my life. So as a teacher, you know, you often have a side jobs, and I had a side job singing. But I also have a side job as an auctioneer. 25, but you get 30, 30, you get 30, but you get 5, 5, but you get 35, but you get 40, can you do it here, but you get 45, 5, but you get 45, bring her in 50, but you get 50, but you get 50, sold for $45. And I've done all kinds of auctions. Well, so I had to write a song about that, so.
The auctioneer
song? Not the auctioneer song, you know what? That's why I went to auction school. I wanted an auction school. At that time, it was a two-week school in Kansas City. It's not in Kansas City anymore, but and I wanted to go and learn how to do that song and say I was an auctioneer, and that's as deep as it got. But I found that I really liked auctioneer. I got hired for weekend and summer work by a local auctioneer and took off with that I can't sing the song very well. And I need to get over that, but I really can't. So I wrote another song about an auction that I can sing. By the way, if you've got any friends of any age, young, old, that are women, I'm talking about women, who would like to find a gentleman, send them to auction school. It's worth the money. There's about 99 men and 2 girls. And, if you're pick of the litter, I'm telling you. So, I'm giving you all kinds of advice you won't find anywhere else. Okay, this is Hazel's auction. Okay, it's auctioneers are not supposed to have any feelings. You know, you sell the stuff and it doesn't matter to you. But I do. I have feelings. And when I see somebody's stuff all scattered out there in the sunlight, it's kind of sad to me, especially if it's a person at the end of the line and they don't have any kin, and there are the tintypes, and there are the quilts, and there are the things that should go to people, but they're not. Either the people are not interested, or there are no descendants. And it kind of makes me sad. My partner, Kevin, he says, Judy, it's just nickels and dimes, nickels and dimes. But to me, it was more. Hazel's house is up for auction, and her life is on display. Family photos on the table, pots and pans in disarray. Clothes are hanging in the backyard, and her quilts upon the fence makes it seem like Hazel's life was of no consequence. Guess that Hazel's old recliner will be worth a buck or two. All her books and horse collection sold to folks she never knew. I suppose it doesn't matter. They're just things she left behind. More important are the memories in my mind. All these people who
Don't see Hazel as a neighbor, or a mother, or a wife. They see blenders, worn out towels, sewing baskets used to mend. But these things of life don't matter in the end. I know that in the springtime, when I drive past this old place, I'll see iris blooming purple, orange lilies tall and straight, and I'll picture my friend Hazel bending low upon her knees, tending flowers, waving happily to me. Although she's no longer with us, Hazel really isn't gone. She still lingers in the stories all her friends share one by one. And I see her in the smile of her little grandson Bill, and in all those pretty flowers on the hill. All these people who are sifting through the remnants of her life don't see Hazel as a neighbor, or a mother, or a wife. They see blenders, worn out towels, sewing baskets used to mend. But these things of life don't matter in the end. No, these things of life don't matter in the end.
Okay. All right. Good morning.
Good morning.
Now, can you all hear me on this?
Yes.
Okay. All right. We're out of here. You guys are so... Look what time it is. You're so good. You are so perfect. Over here on the left that you can't see right now, which is right across from the hotel, is the old Grand Palace Theater, and they're making an aquarium out of that. This is... we're going to have to slow down a little bit.
Again. Yes, ma'am.
That is the Grand Village right there, and that restaurant that you saw, the Mel's Diner, is where they have the singing waiters and waitresses. This is the old Baldnobber Theater, and Grandma sold it, and they're now putting in, Gary, what'd you tell me?
Wonderworks.
I don't know why I can't remember that. I want us to put fun in there somehow, but that's where everything's going to be upside down. So we're interested to see how that's going. Okay, as we're going on down the strip, and by the way, we have a lot of beautiful views as we're on this little sightseeing tour because our roads are up on ridges. Of course, over here, this is where the Country Vault is. We're going to be going to that theater to see the Country Vault. Over here on the left is Presley's Theater. This is the very first theater on the strip. The very first. This was a dirt road. This is the little theater that they said was so far out from town, nobody'd ever come out here. And it was a Quonset hut, because as Lynn told you, Mr. Presley said if our music doesn't go over, we can store boats in here and still make a living. Okay, look up there. You see King Kong up there? You know, we had a tornado here about 5 years ago, and it did not touch King Kong. So he's up there. This is a... wax museum. I'm not a wax museum person, but as far as they go, I think that's a good one. Over here, this is the new venue that I was talking about, behind the camera, behind the lens, and I just really liked it. It was just, it's about all kinds of theories of things that have happened in the country, and a whole room on JFK. It's just really a fun place, kind of a fun place to go. Over here on the left, Clay Cooper Theater. We'll be going there twice because we're going to see number one hits of the 60s, and we're also going to see Clay Cooper show. Clay Cooper and Tina are going to come and talk to us. This is the Titanic over here on the right. The Titanic of...
Yes.
if you've got your car and you've got time, you might want to drive out to Big Cedar and just look around and see what's out there. It's just so beautiful. And of course, Johnny Morris always has the most beautiful scenery, gorgeous scenery. This is Table Rock. This is Moonshine Beach back in there. Moonshine Beach, this is the Bible Belt, remember? So it's Moonshine Beach because of the way the moon shines on the beach, they tell me. My son-in-law, who's lived here all of his life, said, Nana, that is not the reason that's called Moonshine Beach. I think you're right. It is a beautiful lake. Somebody fishing right down there in the boat. You know, after Labor Day, we see very few boats on the lake, and it just amazes me because the lake's always so calm. I don't know why they're not still out here. But we're gonna be going over the dam. Table Rock Lake flows over the dam down into Lake Taneycomo. As I said, Table Rock Lake is our warm water lake. Taneycomo is our cold water lake, so we have trout down there. The cold water is the deep water that comes out of Table Rock. This is a new visitor center out here. Now this side is all windows. I really like that. I think that's great.
Welcome, folks. I'm David. I'm one of the volunteers here. This is an 8-minute video. It goes through the steps we take in raising the trout. It starts with our collecting the eggs, which we call spawning the fish. Real creative. And it ends 18 months later when we're stocking 10 to 12 inch fish for you guys to catch. When the film is over, I'll be back in, try and respond to any questions that you might have. And I got to say it that way because I can't tell you where to buy the next winning lottery ticket. I tried once. And then I'll have a couple of questions for you folks. The answer to my first question is not a bear. It could be, but it won't be. And then I want to talk about some of the other exhibits that we have in here and some of the other things we do here at the hatchery.
Okay, my name is Mitzi, and I'm one of the checkout ladies at the craft mall.
There you go.
And anyway, we have some working vendors in there. We have a lady that makes rugs in there. We have a guy that does pretty paintings. He engraves them. We have a lady that she'll take your name and print it on a piece of paper and tell you what it means. And we have another lady back there that does soap. So we want y'all to just come in and look and have a good time. And we're proud you came. And all the ladies, when you leave, pick up a wooden rose from us. Mark gives every coach the ladies a wooden rose.
So, taking Mitzi's advice, we went inside the store and saw some corn pone humor. Also some unusual gift items like pistol holders, plaques with biblical, patriotic, and fishing themes, sports medallions. Note, there is no pit medallion. That bothers me. Then we went to the Pick and Porch Grill for lunch. We had our choice of three items. This allowed the staff to cook meals for 25 people in a rather timely fashion. After lunch, we went to the Sight and Sound Theater outside town. This is the second Sight and Sound Theater. The original is in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and is the project of a man and a woman who use Old Testament productions to tell a message of Christianity. We were taken behind the scenes and had the opportunity to see all the hard work that goes into costuming, designing sets, and all the other hard work that goes into producing a 2.5-hour production for 4,000 people on a daily basis. It's important to point out at this point that none of the shows, Sight and Sound, or the musical shows that we saw, would allow video filming. It's understandable that they want to protect their copyright and their intellectual property and sell an occasional DVD. So there will be no examples of the actual productions in this video. After Sight and Sound, we went to the Uptown Cafe for dinner.
Gold Star Memoriam. Over on the left, that building on the left used to be the restaurant and the college gift shop and that kind of thing till they moved over here. It is now strictly an alumni building and also some offices of the college.
We may not even have to stop this morning.
Well, we may not. That's good.
Interesting sign. It says Hard Work You.
Uh-huh. Absolutely. If you see anybody working, it will be students.
Unfortunately, our visit to the College of the Ozarks was scheduled for September the 11th, and the campus was having a memorial service for 9/11. The majority of the students were attending the memorial service. College of the Ozarks is a Christian liberal arts college in Hollister, Missouri. It has an enrollment of 1,426, although applications for admissions outstrip the number of students accepted by about 15 to 1. There are 30 academic majors in Bachelor of Science and Bachelor of Arts programs. The most unusual thing about College of the Ozarks is that there is no tuition. The students are expected to work jobs on the campus to help defray the cost of their education. The city accepts no state or federal funds and has a large private endowment.
You guys have done so well. Oh, you did so good. If you went to your room and back, you really did a great job. Anyway, it's time for Tina and Clay, and they're going to be talking about the ins and outs of the other side of the show for us today. We'll see their show tonight, but we are so fortunate to have them, and let's make them welcome.
So my name is Tina, and this is Clay, and Clay's been in Branson since 1986. He originally moved here with a band called the Texas Gold Miners, spelled M-I-N-O-R-S, and that's right, because he was a miner. They had a, well, I'll let you tell that story, Clay. About how you got involved.
Hi, y'all.
Yeah, hi.
Well, I'm from Texas originally.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you've never known it. And as Tina said, I worked with a kids band down there in the Dallas area, and there were eight of us in this band. I was the oldest at 16, and the youngest was 8 years old. This was 1986, and we played our own instruments and sang our own songs and danced and wrote music and worked all over the Texas and Oklahoma and Arkansas and Louisiana. Anyhow, I'll try to keep it short because it's kind of a long story. But we got an audition to come to Branson, Missouri in 1986 at the Ozark Jubilee Theater, which is no longer on the Strip. It used to be on the Strip. And we all hopped in two vans and drove to Branson, Missouri. Never heard of it, never been here. And we all piled up the vans about 9 o'clock it's 9 o'clock in the evening. We pulled in, and the theater was having a show there that night. So we walked in. It was around intermission time, and all of us kids and some of the parents that went with us that drove us up walked in, and I just remember looking up there. I've never seen anything like it. There were all these this show, and these guys were wearing gray tuxedos and purple cummerbunds and a purple bow tie, and they were all singing country music, and I'm like, I've never seen anybody sing country music in a cummerbund.
Sometimes a lot of owners think that they have all the answers. We know we don't, so we're already a step ahead of most of them. You can go to the next one. And so we try to do a lot of fun things with our staff, so I just kind of put together a little video to show you what we kind of do with them.
How do I make, I think you got to hit the space bar on the left.
We took them up all to a baseball game together there.
We have Thanksgiving dinner together.
Yeah, we have a big Thanksgiving. We deep fried turkeys backstage. We rented a big houseboat and went on the lake a few times there.
Those are all our techs. That was a movie night.
Uh-huh. Yeah, we rent out movie theaters and stuff.
Again.
Yeah.
They're big on eating. Sarah and Nate, the two over there, had just opened up their own business. Wendell is 96.
World War II veteran that ushered for us.
Football games with Colton.
Our son Colton.
Silver Dollar City. We went to Silver Dollar City to see. Have a good day there. Concessions, playing with Clay.
Boat day.
This is when we do our road travels. They do a lot of fun stuff together. Boy Scouts.
Boy Scouts, yeah.
That's our wardrobe gal.
She does our wardrobe, yeah. She loves it when I hug her.
I have some 2 o'clock. And that's probably what Bill has. We are so fortunate. You've already met Bill. We're so fortunate to have Bill and his wife Gail and Mike Cathcart. And they're going to entertain us today. You will be just blown away. So let's welcome them very.
Okay, good way.
Okay, on the way to here.
And I'll be there someday if you will hold my hand. I still need you there beside me, no matter what I do. For I know I'll never find another you.
There is always someone for each of us, they say.
The water tastes like wine. I'm going.
Walk up here all the time. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Well, I'm glad to see so many smiling faces so early in the morning. So I will try my best to keep you awake and let you know a little bit about wardrobe. Welcome to the world of wardrobe. This is a part of the theater that's the fun part because you get to play dress-ups. The first part, that was his easy singing, and then the second part, he would have a tribute of some sort. And we did that many times. Then in the late 90s, Andy decided that he'd make a variety thing coming on, so he hired Rich Little and Sherry Lewis to come in and do the afternoon shows during the summer, and then he did the evening shows, so he was taking a little break just to do evening shows. I want to introduce to you Josh Carroll from Raiders of the
Raiders of the Lost Ark.
I was young when they filmed that.
I said that one time.
So I'm trying not to do that again. Later, Raiders of the Country Vault. He's one of the entertainers, and he also comes and visits with us about the Raiders of the Country Vault. And any questions that you have would be great. And let's make Josh welcome.
Well, how y'all doing today?
Good.
Are you learning some good stuff?
Yes.
You mind if I sit down and relax? I have four shows today, so this is my first appearance of four. My name's Josh. I'm with Raiding the Country Vault. Currently, I'm one of the male leads and the musical director. So I'm the one that makes sure all the music gets put together properly and all that kind of stuff. Now, y'all are coming to the show tonight, right?
Yes.
All right. Well, you're going to have fun. We definitely like to bring a party, have a good time for sure. Now, a good thing I talk about, obviously, is with songwriting. I co-wrote a couple top 40 hits, which is always nice to have in your back pocket. And then also, the best thing about it is the touring aspect of stuff. I toured for 10 years from coast to coast, you name it, from Kennebunkport, Maine, all the way down to San Diego, up to Portland, all the way down to Miami. We covered the entire country. And some of the experiences and the people that you get to work with and work for and the big names and the artists and the huge shows and stuff. And there's a lot of questions that come with that. So I think it's what we'll do is we'll just start off. This is one of the songs that we wrote. It was number 42 on the Billboard charts. And I'll just go ahead and play it. And the girl that's singing it, her name is Candy Coburn. Currently now she lives down in Austin, Texas. For the past 7-8 years, she's been the celebrity ambassador for Susan G. Komen for The Cure. I'm sure you've all heard of that, especially coming up in October. If you yourselves have had breast cancer or anybody in your family, then you understand exactly the toll it takes. And being a male, we don't have to worry about that near as much. But when you go and you play for a long time, for about 3 years, we toured. And we played every one of those three-day walks that you all hear about, you know, and it's some of the most inspiring. It's insane. It's hard to even put it into words. It really is. The things that women go through and the strength that you truly do have that's taken for granted. It's just, I get chills thinking about it. Y'all are absolutely fantastic. So give yourselves a hand. I'll tell you that right now. So, I mean.
After Josh completed his presentation, we got in our big red bus and went off to lunch at the Grand Country Buffet. Then in a whirlwind of activity, we took in an afternoon matinee of music of the 60s, went to dinner at Landry's restaurant, returned to the Clay Cooper Theater for the evening show of Raiding the Country Vault. That completed our program. I hope you've enjoyed this video.